Hello, Malty Malt Maths. I'm Ralphie. Welcome to Whisky Review 605. And thank you to Freddie de Gent, for the malt mention. I'm Ralphie. I review whiskies and other quality spirits from around the world, and I've been doing so for many years. I've been drinking spirits for a long time, and for most, well, nearly all that time, in moderation, and I've been sticking to quality, not quantity. And mindful as I am that one of the risks of drinking alcohol is that you can get drunk. So you have these two basic states, sober and drunk. But it's more complex than that. You know it and I know it. Let's articulate it. I'm going to give you an opinion, a perspective on the different stages of intoxication, because we don't just go from being stone cold sober to being drunk, although for some people they can do it in a very short space of time, but for most of us it can take a while, and for many of us we never really go too far down the road to complete drunkenness, because it's simply an unwanted and uncomfortable experience. And also, it's a health risk, not just to ourselves, but potentially to others around us. So here we are, here's the board, the seven levels of intoxication, numbered 1 to 7. I shall go through them one by one with the assistance of a little inspirational glass of whiskey out of my little ornamental flask. There we go. Stage one, the gentle buzz. This happens when we pour a glass of whiskey and we nose it. And as soon as we nose it, our brains recognize that smell and start to prepare us for the effects of consuming alcohol. Because the brain is one of the first areas of our bodies to really get the experience of it. Alcohol is absorbed through the linings of our skin, our tissue, an internal tissue. It's rather like aspirin in that respect. It doesn't need to be digested in our stomachs before our brain is very much aware of its influence and presence. Even the smell alone starts to prepare the brain for the first taste, that wonderful moment. Generally, very positive, so long as it's good quality liquor. And literally within a few seconds of the first taste, we are being prepared physiologically for that little buzz, that gentle buzz, that positive, life-enhancing, warming glow that you get from one single glass of spirits. So make sure it's a decent measure, malt mates. Never give yourself too little of a good thing. The philosophers of old enjoyed this moment. The Chinese sages would sit in fields of flowers and contemplate the nature of life and universe over a glass of wine. The Greek philosophers would sit in their baths of hot water with their wines infused with herbs, tonics, and mild hallucinogens in order to help them and enable them to think deeper and further on the mysteries of life. And even the priests in the temples of Egypt would infuse their beers with some obscure lilies from the River Nile, knowing that it would take them to more spiritual places than mere spirit would allow them to venture. No pun intended. It's a lovely spot. It's the first moment, the first contact, and we'd love it to last longer, but it doesn't, because we swiftly move on to level two after 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 glasses of whiskey, tipsy and jolly. You see, alcohol's a depressant. it is, that's its effect on the brain. But before that effect kicks in, it can actually be enhancing, mood enhancing. We start to laugh a little bit more, we get a little bit louder, we're jolly, we're having good conversations and good company, and you can always tell good company, malt mates, when you can cover the three dangerous subjects and nobody has a fallout and nobody takes offence: money, religion and sex. There you go. If you can discuss these three things, particularly all together over a conversation, then you know you're in good company. So you're tipsy. The buzz is a little buzzier. It's more persistent. It's more proactive. It's more assertive on you. And you know that you're still in charge of your faculties, but you're feeling the influence of alcohol now. You positively know it's there. And you're quite jolly and animated, and things are going well, and things are fine. And it would be great if that could hang around for longer, but it really depends how slowly you're drinking and how much you're drinking, because if you start to drink more, tipsy turns to dizzy, the third level in the layers of intoxication. Dizzy. This is where you know that you're no longer sober. You can't say you're a little bit tipsy, because it's more aggressive than that, more persistent, more proactive. You're slurring now slightly. Your thoughts are perhaps a little more easily distracted and fuzzy and cloudy. You're stumbling when you're going down steps or walking along a pavement. It's not persistent, it's intermittent, it's occasional, but you know that you're feeling the effects of alcohol. You're aware of it, but it's manageable, it's in control. But if it's not in control, if you've not said enough, because this is the point where you're getting a little bit dizzy, you've got to say enough. And it's a skill that we all need to be aware of, to say, right, I've had enough. I'm not having any more. I'm stopping drinking. I can cover that glass, right, too. I'll cover it with a glass cover. There we go, it's a glass cover. I'll cover it and I'll finish it tomorrow. Or I'll come back later, or perhaps I won't have it at all. I'll put it in a rum punch or whatever, I don't know. But these moments, enough is enough. You know you're dizzy, because if you don't say enough, you'll reach level four in the seven levels of intoxication, and that is uncomfortable, the uncomfortable zone, the middle distance. We're no longer in the nice green positive area. We're in the borderline. We're looking at the red zone beyond, the darker side of intoxication. And when we're uncomfortable, it's a good position to be, because if you can recognize that discomfort and react to it, you won't be drinking anymore. You will walk away from the alcohol before the effects of the intoxication take more of a proactive grip on you. That uncomfortable zone is well worth knowing. For me, I can drink quite a lot of whiskey, but I can drink very little rum indeed. With gin, I don't have to worry, because I'll get sleepy very quickly. Rather than uncomfortable, I'll just stop. But with scrumpy and cider, I get very uncomfortable very quickly, and I basically avoid these beverages. You've never seen a cider review at Ralphie.com, and there's a reason for that. That just wrecks me. Cider and apple. Fermented apples. Calvados is fine, but fermented apple juice kills me. I had a bad experience once with a gallon of scrumpy. If you ignore the uncomfortable warnings, you move on to level five of the levels, seven levels of intoxication. This is bad company. You will see it in others, where other people become bad company because their intoxication is making them loud, irritating. They're making an uncomfortable atmosphere in the area that they're around, whether they happen to be in your social group or another social group near you. They laugh too loud, they laugh too long, they move too aggressively, Their mood swings become more transparent and they're frequently boring, really quite boring. Bad company. We have to be aware that we do not ourselves become bad company, because good friendships take a lot of nurturing and cultivating over time, and they can quite quickly be lost if you become bad company to others. And it's something that, as an online reviewer and blogger, when I ever attend a whisky festival, I am acutely aware, as you should be too if you attend a whisky festival, that you need to observe the protocols of managing your alcohol consumption, because you are being watched, you are being observed, and you are being constantly assessed by industry professionals as to whether you can handle your drink or not. And quite right too. Are you or are you not bad company? If you are, you are rapidly becoming simply drunk. Level 6 of the seven levels of intoxication. There's no ambiguity, there's no complications about it. You are simply drunk. Simply drunk means that it's not a positive thing, it's not a nice thing. Some drunks are benign drunks, they're happy drunks and jolly drunks, and they're lucky. They can get away with it. Many are not. Many can be physically abusive to others, to themselves. They can fall down, lose their balance, break their nose in the paving slabs under their feet. All sorts of things can happen. They can be arrested, they can be abused, they can be taken advantage of, they can be drugged. It's a nightmare. Never go out on a weekend to get drunk. Many people do. And they're always the worse for it, never the better. Because beyond that, for those who are regularly drunk and increase that frequency of being simply drunk, they are moving into that final seventh level of intoxication, and that is the alcoholic spiral. Now notice that I've underlined spiral. I'm going to come to that shortly. The alcoholic is someone who ceases to function in a sober state and functions under the constant influence, profound influence of alcohol. It is a tragic, they wreck their own lives, both psychologically and physically. They physically deteriorate, they can be laughed at and ridiculed, and they seem to accommodate that. They are a hazard to themselves, and frequently, more often than not, a hazard and a liability to first their friends, who they lose, and then latterly their family, who at times have to abandon them because they have no choice. The rest of the family must keep themselves together. And an alcoholic can wreck a family. An alcoholic is a tragic figure, but never ever sympathise with them. Never sympathise with them. Never ever let them know, it's all right, it's not you, it's the drink. No, it's not the drink, it's them. It's them with the drink, in tandem, together and inseparable. In the presence of an alcoholic, hide all alcohol. Do not discuss it. Offer tea and biscuits. Do not sympathise, but lend a sympathetic ear, an encouraging ear, a supportive ear, a few, some helpful words, but that's as much as it goes. Alcoholics need professional help because they are killing themselves and wrecking others around them. That's what it does. Alcohol can be hugely destructive. It kills millions of people each year around the world, and I am not ashamed to mention that it needs to be mentioned. It really, really does. It's very important. We can know someone perhaps who's been a whisky companion, a malt mate, but we notice something happens, a change in their circumstances, the loss of a loved one, who knows, and they start to drink more heavily because they're drinking for a different purpose. It's as simple as that. A different motivation, different reason. And that is the alcoholic spiral, because that spiral that I mentioned earlier, and I've underlined it, is going downwards, always moving, never static. Alcohols are not static. Alcoholics are not static in their situation. They are always deteriorating if they are not recovering alcoholics. Recovering alcoholics will always be open and upfront about it and should never be criticised for being honest about the situation, because in being honest and being open about being recovering alcoholics, then that is the cue. Don't mention alcohol, don't bring out alcohol, don't even drink alcohol with in front of them. It can be enough of a trigger to do damage, to some terrible damage, and set things back. Alcohol is a toxic poison, but only in excess. The skill is knowing where is the green zone and where is the red zone. That's the skill. It's knowing when alcohol is doing you good in small quantities and in quality, and when it's doing you bad, when you're just drinking too much for the sake of it. I'm Ralphie. This was a whisky review. I've concluded it now, and my next whisky review, 606, will be a review of a single malt Scotch whisky. There you go. Now you know. I hope you'll join me and share the malt moments, which will be along shortly. In the meantime, I'm going to finish off this whisky and contemplate yet again, because we should always be mindful of it, the seven levels of intoxication. I'm in level one, and I think that's where I'll stay for the moment.